In June 2022, the US Supreme Court overturned Roe v. Wade, ending the constitutional right to abortion.
It's a sad day for the court and for the country.
The court's decision was celebrated by conservatives, despite having an immediate impact on women's access to healthcare.
This is a nightmare!
I'm 21 and I'm terrified!
It sends a message that women should not have control over their bodies.
The decision comes after former President Trump nominated three Supreme Court justices during his presidential term.
The justices that I'm going to appoint will be pro-life. They will have a conservative bent. They will be protecting the Second Amendment.
America's highest court is in danger of losing the support of the people it is meant to serve.
Confidence in the Supreme Court is lower now than it has ever been.
Now many are questioning the existence of an unelected branch of government with the power to reshape America.
They have engaged in overreach, and it is the responsibility of the president and Congress to put the Supreme Court in check.
The court's justices promise to only interpret the Constitution, free from any underlying biases.
I'm just here to apply the law and adhere to the rule of law.
The court isn't showing any kind of sensitivity to the realities that people are living in the 21st century.
But the Republican support for Brett Kavanaugh, despite accusations of sexual assault, show how politicized the court has become.
This whole two-week effort has been a calculated and orchestrated political hit.
If the Supreme Court is just another political institution and just another political voice, why do we need it?
USA!
So how did a court created to protect the rights of Americans end up rolling them back? And as this politicized court continues to lose the support of the people,
my body, my choice,
is it in danger of becoming a broken institution?
According to a statement from the Supreme Court,
Ruth Bader Ginsburg,
who was far more than merely a Supreme Court justice, has died.
Ruth Bader Ginsburg was a beloved Supreme Court justice who believed in a woman's right to abortion.
This is something central to a woman's life, to her dignity.
Despite her widespread admiration from the left, her decision not to step down during the Obama administration paved the way for Trump to appoint three justices during his presidency.
There has never been anything like what we've been able to do together with judges.
These confirmations would ultimately change the lives of millions of women.
By a vote of 5-4, the court overturned Roe and the follow-on rulings that said states cannot ban abortion before the age of fetal viability.
Roe versus Wade wouldn't have been overruled if Justice Ginsburg were still on the court. There had only been four votes.
Lifetime appointments are intended to insulate the justices from politics, but Justice Ginsburg's death highlights how they have had the opposite effect.
Too much depends now on the accident of timing for when a vacancy occurs. That's too much power in a single person's hands for too long a period of time.
It's one reason why during confirmation hearings, nominees are meant to prove their neutrality and that they deserve this job for life.
The Supreme Court must never, never be viewed as a partisan institution.
But what is meant to be an opportunity for accountability has frequently become a kind of political circus. In 2018, Trump's Supreme Court nominee Brett Kavanaugh faced allegations of sexual assault.
I believed he was going to rape me. I tried to yell for help. When I did, Brett put his hand over my mouth.
The combative nature of the hearing and the media that surrounded it cemented in the minds of the public that the court is just another political body.
What you want to do is destroy this guy's life, hold this seat open, and hope you win in 2020.
Conservatives decided we need to rush this through as quickly as we possibly can. We're going to rally the troops who are going to hear from us, hey, this is just a smear campaign.
Just 2 years earlier, the Republican Senate leader, Mitch McConnell, blocked President Obama's choice for a justice, claiming it was too close to an election.
We're not giving a lifetime appointment to this president on the way out the door to change the Supreme Court for the next 25 or 30 years.
But after Justice Ginsburg's death, when it was a nomination for his party, McConnell organized a vote for Trump's pick days ahead of an election.
And so then everybody's antenna went up and said, wait, something's off about this process, and we can't really trust the decisions that are being made there anymore.
With 6 out of 9 currently serving justices appointed by Republican presidents, Mitch McConnell's hypocrisy has paid off. But for many, it points to a system in desperate need of reform.
You could have staggered and term-limited seats on the Supreme Court rather than appointing someone in their 50s who might rule for 40 years and be increasingly out of touch to having maybe 18-year terms.
I'd like to see an expansion of the size of the Supreme Court. 9 is an arbitrary number. Unless there's an expansion of the size of the Supreme Court, we are going to have a very conservative Supreme Court for decades to come.
A fundamental role of the Supreme Court is to protect the rights of minorities against overreach by Congress and the president.
Imagine that you're unable to build political majorities in democracy. Well, what appeal can you have except to, hopefully, the court, right, to the laws of the country?
But from reinforcing the property rights of slave owners to Japanese detention during World War II, the Supreme Court has historically upheld laws that disenfranchised minorities. The Dobbs v. Jackson decision that overturned Roe v. Wade is no exception.
This is the first time the court has overturned a precedent to restrict freedom, to go backward.
When you put abortion out of reach for people safely, that doesn't mean that they will stop having abortions.
You have states that are enacting bans on abortion at 6 weeks, and not necessarily with exceptions for health or rape or incest. So it's going to have a dramatic effect.
This ban on abortion oversimplifies the consequences on women's health and society at large.
People who are compelled to have a baby because they do not have access to abortion do not give those children up for adoption. They keep the children. That means added pressures on families who are already struggling.
And in a country where Black women are more than 3 times more likely to die from pregnancy-related complications, not everyone will equally share the burden.
Black women already have a far higher rate of maternal mortality than white women. So this is a decision that is going to harm people in multiple ways.
Another mass shooting in America. This one at an elementary school.
10 people were killed when a gunman opened fire.
At an Indianapolis mall, an alleged gunman shot and killed 3 people and injured 2 more.
In the first half of 2022, America has had more than 350 mass shootings. Despite this, the Supreme Court ruled in June that a law restricting concealed weapons in New York was unconstitutional.
There was basically a permitting regime in New York that said you had to have a good reason in order to possess a firearm. And the court thought that that was a restriction that went too far, that violated the Second Amendment.
The decision ignores the shocking crisis of gun violence every day, engulfing not only New York, but engulfing our entire country.
The judges are accused of reinterpreting the Second Amendment, which gives people the right to keep and bear arms.
The Second Amendment had not been construed by the Supreme Court for 200 years. And then you have 5 justices of 9 come in and say, this is the way the Second Amendment has to be read. I think for many Americans, they find that highly problematic.
It's a view of a constitution rooted in an extremely conservative ideology called originalism.
Originalism is the idea that you're going to base current interpretations of the Constitution based on what the drafters of the Constitution had to say.
It sells itself as a way of constraining judges.
I interpret the Constitution as a law, that I interpret its text as text, and I understand it to have the meaning that it had at the time people ratified it.
But in reality, originalism allows conservative judges to upend fundamental precedents that few Americans would want removed.
The court is reading rights into the Constitution that it believes are there, even without really solid evidence, like the right to carry guns in public, and reading out rights that have been long recognized and respected, like the right to reproductive autonomy.
Originalism is just one tactic that conservative judges have used to undermine the democratic process.
The Supreme Court has unleashed a flood of secret corporate money into our political system.
In their 2010 Citizens United case, the court ruled that corporations can spend unlimited money on campaign finance due to their First Amendment rights to freedom of speech.
What the court has really done is really open the floodgates for private money to come influence elections and even further skew the results of our political process.
And in the 2013 Shelby v. Holder decision, the court undid a key provision of the Voting Rights Act, which was created to protect African Americans from discrimination.
It took certain jurisdictions that had deep histories of segregation and voter discrimination and voter intimidation and said, before you make any changes in the law, the federal government needs to look at this.
This move by the court allowed a wave of restrictive voting laws in states like Georgia, which now requires ID for mail-in voting. This targets African Americans who overwhelmingly vote Democratic.
We will not be able to litigate our way out of this threat to Black citizenship, voting, and political participation.
As the court becomes more out of step with the American people, some are asking, why should a democracy be ruled by a court that no one voted for?
The Supreme Court has become a real barrier to democratic self-governance in America. It empowers the wealthy, it empowers white people who are trying to disenfranchise the other, and it does really lead to our political process being less responsive than it really should be.
Under similar principles for overturning Roe, there are fears that the court may roll back other constitutional protections as soon as next term.
This Roe opinion could affect other rights that many Americans in this country take for granted, like the right to conception or the right to same-sex marriage.
The Supreme Court's going to hear challenges to affirmative action. This fundamental question about a racial reckoning, about equality in the society, will be dealt a terrible blow if the court strikes down affirmative action regimes.
I am pleased to welcome Justice Jackson to the court and to our common calling.
Although the Senate confirmed Ketanji Brown Jackson, the first Black female Supreme Court justice, the court's conservative supermajority will remain intact.
It's easy to imagine this group of justices being together another decade or more.
For many, the court's recent decisions are proof that it has always been a political body with the power to reshape America into its own image.
If ultimately in American democracy there is no faith in the rule of law because there's no faith in the court, I think fascism is certainly enabled when the people lose faith in their fundamental values and believe that it really is just us versus them.